tester.co.uk.
Hello YouTubers and welcome to this T4D. Now, I've turned this into a T4D because what I'm going to be doing today is transforming a transformer. So that DIY transformer that I built for my own electronic DC load, I put that together in South Africa and it was specifically designed to work off 220 or 230 volts. And obviously I need it to work off 110, 120 volts here in the States. Now, I literally have not touched it at all, so I'm gonna go through the whole process. As I say, it's not a tutorial per se, because you're just gonna watch what I'm doing on the bench in terms of fiddling with it, converting it. I might come up against some challenges and problems that I didn't resolve when I was back in South Africa when I was building this. But we'll talk about the end goal of that soon enough. I have taken on board the advice in terms of the lighting, and you're spot on. The lighting that I was using was a very cold white. So I have got 150 watt halogen light up over there, providing some warm light, but I am getting some other warmer lights to kind of make the lighting better. And again, it's going to be a work in process. So as I film and I see things aren't working, I'll try and work on improving the lighting and the sound. Now, what I'm going to do, I'm going to quickly grab my other camera again, because there's just been a few subtle changes to the lab. I'll show you, walk you through those, and then we'll jump onto the bench and start looking at that transformer. Right, so let's just have a quick look at the bench. Now, before we look at the bench, I'll just show you. So what I've decided to do is the camera that I'm using here is my old Sony, the cheaper camera, and it happens to work far better in terms of having a wide angle zoom and the autofocus than my more expensive Canon. So the more expensive Canon is going to be permanently set up there for filming myself with the Rode mic. As I said, the sound's still a work in progress. I have got other stands coming with warm white light, so that's going to be happening on that side of the room. And then in terms of lighting on this side, although you'll perhaps have recognized there are these two LED spots, I changed them. One had the multiple LEDs in them and it was cold. These are more warm white and they don't flicker in the camera. So the cold ones and the multiple LEDs, they caused flicker, so I've changed to those. I've also gone and mounted that trip light power strip on the back. It really is a lovely aluminium casing on here. That's basically for any ad hoc things I need to plug in. Because the other power strips are kind of out the way, and I'm going to reserve those for permanent equipment on the bench. If, like today, we're going to be working on this power supply, when I need to plug that in, that's what I'd use this power strip for. So I've got two of these. I still have to put one up on the other side of the bench. And then I have managed to get hold of the kind of joining knuckle for my Manfrotto Magic Arm camera setup, so I can do over the head shots now, ready for reviews on the bench and this work. And again, with this camera, I'm able to get a nice wide angle, because with the Canon, this would have been too low. I would have needed the Canon sitting about this high in able to get a good spread across the bench, but at least that's resolved. Then a few bits that arrived. I have got the scale, because we're going to be measuring energy storage devices, because ultimately that's why I am building this, or trying to get this AC to DC adapter working, so that I can demonstrate the work I did in South Africa with my DIY load and the energy sources I was testing there, where ultimately we're going to move on to the bigger batteries and the Manuo electronic DC load. Now, under the bench, something I want to show you, and again, thanks to Sean, he mentioned, and I hadn't realized this, that by all accounts, and it'll be interesting to get your feedback because I haven't really properly researched this, but houses in the States, by default, it seems, in their DB boards don't have a trip switch or an earth leakage switch. The breakers are obviously protect for overload, but not for earth leakage. So, of course, that potentially means that you're not protected against, if you get a shock, then you've got nothing that's going to trip. So they do, for the most part, certainly in our condo, in the kitchen and the bathroom, have the GFCI, or the ground fault circuit interrupt power points, but not in the bedrooms or the lounges or what have you. So I've gone and put a strip in, which has got that protection, particularly as I'm working on the bench and something could go awry. So that's got a test button. It works when I switch it. I've then also got some power surge protection for the equipment. And then over here, what's this, Martin? Okay, so it's not for storing my Bitcoins and it's not for storing my custard creams. On the top, you'll note I've got a little filter, which will be for an inlet at the back of the bottom. And I've got an AC speed variable fan, which will go in the top at the back so I can circulate air. And in a video to come, I'll explain what that's all about. Right, so let's talk about the end goal so that we've got an appreciation of why I'm trying to kind of work on this AC to DC transformer now to get this up and running. So I mentioned this before that in South Africa, once I had built this in conjunction with this and my metrics multimeter, I was able to charge and then basically discharge and log the power, performance, and output of various energy storage devices, whether they were lithium or lithium iron phosphate or hybrid or super capacitors or normal batteries. And basically what I wanted to do was build up a database of these, noting their performance, their discharge profile, and their energy density. So you can also measure power density. I wasn't too interested in power density, but energy density basically gives you an idea of the amount of energy per weight that you can install. So once you have a storage device's energy density, you can see how efficient it is. So you may be able to, let's say, store 2 watt hours in here, but in this device, you can have 10 watt hours. And then you'd realize that this energy density is better. And if you're trying to power an RC car where weight was potentially an issue, well, then you want to go for the item with the highest energy density. So these, for certain projects, can be quite useful in terms of understanding the discharge profile, how quickly the voltage drops, does it maintain a steady voltage and then drop off quickly or drop off slowly. And I've been building an Excel spreadsheet graphing all that information. And I've got quite a fair bit of information in there already, but I want to build on that. So ultimately, that's the end goal and why I want to get this up and running and get the battery testing underway again. But for today, it's a case of converting this to run off 110 and still give me a reasonable output. Right, now as you may recall from the I did a couple of videos before building this. I did one where I went through the exercise of putting it together on a breadboard, and then I went from kind of breadboard to prototyping board, and I drew up and went through all the calculations on how it worked. Now for me, on the breadboard, I managed to get my design goal was to have it working at, it needed to work at 12 volts at 43 milliamp, but ultimately I wanted it to do at least 12 volts at about 100 milliamp. And on the breadboard, I was able to do that. However, when it came to putting it all together and putting it in here, and in essence, barring some fuses, the circuit was the same. The output voltage had dropped to around 11.5, as I recall. So something in the circuit seemed to be dropping some voltage or what have you. There's been some talk that it might be the LED, but I had this all together, I say, on the breadboard. So I'm not too sure it was, and unfortunately now that we're here in the States at a different voltage, I don't have a transformer to give me 220 at this point in time. We're not going to be able to resolve that. So the end goal now is to try and get this to operate off 110, 120, and still provide, I at least need 6 volts out of it, but ultimately I'd like to still get the 12 volts out of it. Now, the transformer that I purchased in South Africa, you'll note, it's got some tappings over here. And I'll just zoom in a little closer for you to have a look. So it's got these tappings over here, and you'll see that it actually notes, it says 12012 AC. And just note, it is AC, because I know some people were getting confused and saying, well, how on earth was I going to have enough voltage out? So the peak voltage out of that is around 16 or 17 volts AC. So it's got a center tap, and what I'm also going to demonstrate later on, and I spoke about this, we'll do it on paper, is just show you the design, how you can design a full wave rectifier with just 2 diodes because you have this center tap. Now for me in this design, I'm only using 2 taps. So I'm using the kind of center 0 volt or ground and the 12 volt to go into the circuit below because that's all I needed. However,
I now need more voltage out of this. This, although this says on here 240 volt AC is what this transformer is rated for, I'm only going to be running this at, say, 110, 120 volts. So for one, can I do that? In my mind, yes, I should. I'm going below. If it was only safely rated for 240, I'm now running at half that. But that means potentially I'm only going to get half the voltage out of between these two, or across all of them. But if my voltage is halved, what I can do is then take the voltage between the two outer ones. So in theory, that should give me, again, double up. But that's what we're going to see. So we're going to take this apart. We're going to take I first of all need to connect a US plug onto it. I'm going to connect it up. We'll take the measurements as it is in the output now. And then we'll go and have a look at how I can rig this up to get the required voltage. Okay, and I just note, so I do use this very crude method of using this little pen knife with a little scissors to kind of get the initial insulation of the power cable cut back. In that process, sometimes you have to be wary, because if you do nick the insulation on the actual wire, that's potentially a risk. So what I'm going to do is cut that back to make sure I've got just clean, unnicked insulation. Take those off. And then here we go. These are the new strippers which I bought off Amazon. And again, all the bits and pieces basically which I found useful in putting my bench together. So the bench, the lights, the power strips, the GFCI plugs, all of that is in a link below on my Amazon store if you're interested. Okay, so basically in this, I place it in there like that. Let's see how well it works. Bango. Done. So it auto adjusts. And so far, I must say, this has worked really well as a wire stripper. Naughty me, I had to go back because I didn't get them quite the same length. I will probably end up obviously chopping these once I actually sold them. But it's always risky stripping for a second time, because invariably you start catching the conductors and pulling the conductors out. Now, I was fortunate I saw only one strand come out, so I can live with that, but something to be aware of. Right, so I've got all the wire strips. I'm now going to go over to my soldering station and get that ready to solder these together and put some heat shrink on. Rightio, so I've gone and shifted the camera to the other bench. It's just made me realize I need another clamp so I can get you easily to work. I've pulled out the bits and pieces I think I'll need. I'm obviously going to use some heat shrink, so I've got that. I've got my little new heat gun so I can demonstrate how that works. And then, as I said, I've got this bamboo chopping board, which I now am going to use to actually solder on. As I said, I don't mind sacrificing the surface. That's what I bought it for. Got some insulation tape. I'll quickly pivot the camera around so you can actually see the rest of the station. So I've got then my Hacco FX888 soldering station, which, as I said, I'm very pleased about. And what I also have, which I need to rig up, I've got this variable speed fan just to take away any kind of fumes from the soldering. So I'm going to hook that up now and see how well that works. So here we go. It's the Thermaltake little fan. It's got a little variable resistor rheostat over here, which has actually got a nice smooth action to it. You can actually see it can rev up quite high. It's got, comes with a little stand. Again, I think it's something I put on the list with the setup of my bench. It's got this very thin ribbon cable, which has got a USB connector, and I've got a USB to AC adapter, which is how I'm powering it. Now it's blowing air out this way, so I'm going to switch this around and see how well it obviously works that way. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to get a small zip tie because I don't want this wire dangling about. I'll fix that up, I'll start soldering and see how well it works. Right, So I've gone and zip tied the kind of lead to that fan. I've got it on a slow RPM. We'll see how it works. And just to note, everyone, literally you're coming along with me for the ride today. I did no real prep. I wanted to kind of do it as it happened. So any hiccups or what have you along the way, I'm still trying to resolve little issues with the workspace and how to make it work well. One thing I'll note, so I've got the first power lead set up ready to tin the ends. I've got some, what's this shop again? Radio Shack. Radio Shack solder. It is lead-free solder. Now, I've never used lead-free solder before, and I was forced to do that because I was hunting down some solder off Amazon, and I couldn't see any with good reviews. So in the end, I went for this 0.3. I wanted thin solder. I went for this, what would you call that? BOG, I don't know. And I tell you, what rubbish. I suppose I've been fortunate through my life that, you know, solder lasts a long time. So when I've had solder, it's obviously been relatively good. It's worked well and I've not had hiccups. I tried to use this to join two power cables together and my solder work looked very amateurish. I don't do a lot of soldering. I'm certainly not a great solderer, but adequate, I'd say. And this made my soldering look totally amateurish. So just be aware of that. Do try and find someone or get a recommendation on solder, because if you pick the wrong solder, it's certainly not going to help your cause, especially if you're learning to solder. But anyway, this lead-free stuff from Radio Shack, for the most part at the moment, seems to be doing the job. It's thicker than I perhaps would want. I need to get something that is kind of either 0.3 or 0.5 millimeter, but it's fine for the time being. Especially with a bigger work like this, it doesn't really matter. Right, so sorry, I kept you zoomed out for that one. So for the next one, I'll zoom you in. In fact, I'll zoom you in a little bit closer so you can, if you really want to criticize what I'm doing, you can have a closer look and do that. These seem to have tinned up okay, so now it's the turn of the other end. There you go, and you'll have to excuse, I'm just noting on the camera the color seems a little bit washed out perhaps, but I've got, again, I've kind of jury-rigged one of the cool white lights up there, just so I've got some light over here. Just to note, I've only got the fan on low RPM, but it certainly seems to be doing the job. I've normally sat in the fumes or kind of tried to blow it out the way. It's the first time I've done this, and I should have done it years ago. But just that little simple fan on a stand over there certainly does seem to be doing the job. It seems to be pulling the fumes away as I solder. Right, so the next job is to then kind of pick out some heat shrink, which what I want to do is obviously cover both of the power wires over here, and then one that goes over the top to kind of make it look neat. So I'm just going to try and pick out from my multicolored box of heat shrink the right sizes. Now then, got to be careful. The wire size and the insulation is different on both sides, and I've just realized that that's not going to fit over that end. So what I might do for belts and braces, I might use this thinner stuff for that, a slightly thicker one on this side to overlap, and then another one over the top. Yeah, that one's going to be too tight. I can see I'm going to fight with that. I'll have to use the whole piece there. Now, something to note, and I kind of had these long enough so I could have insulation on here. Perhaps they're a bit, maybe a little bit too long. I could have gone slightly shorter, but anyway, we'll make do. Obviously, I need to snip these off just so that we match the sizes together so that they neatly overlap. Sod's law, that would shoot far away. I should have my fingers on it. Right, and I did manage to find the other piece, fortunately. It could have shot away and never to be found again, but invariably always try and grab those before you snip them, because if they end up jumping up, like for instance my variable power supply has got air slits on the top, if that had to spring off and go into the top of the power supply, it could be rather nasty. And obviously, I know it sounds perhaps a silly thing to say, but obviously remember to get your heat shrink on first before you start soldering, or else you have to undo everything to get it on. And obviously slide it down. The risk is that if your soldering iron is too hot, now I'm working at about 300 degrees Celsius. For finer solder work, perhaps around 200, 250, but for when I'm doing wiring to make it the ends heat up easily, I work around 300 or 350 if need be. But if the wires heat up too much, then these are going to shrink on before you want them to. So you want to try and get them as far down as possible so they're out the way. Okay. So I'm ready to go. This isn't a soldering lesson per se because, as I said, my skills are mediocre. What I tend to do when I'm just about to join and my hands are going to be full, I tend to try and tie the solder up so that I can kind of put a bit on the end of the soldering iron and reach for it while I'm actually soldering. So I tie it up so it's there ready for me to go towards as opposed to being loose and moving around. That's just the way I do it. And invariably I've got the solder twisted around the cable to the soldering iron. No worries. It will do, he says. There you go. Reasonably clean compared to when I did the solder joint I did with the other solder. That one was just a mess. It just wouldn't melt. It was like trying to spread butter to basically try and get the solder joint done. Okay, and I'm sorry that went a bit off camera. I didn't realize where the camera was actually zoomed in. Not my forte trying to solder on camera. But anyway, there you go, you get to see it. So there we go, those should do the job. Not too mucky. The next job is obviously to put the heat shrink on. I'll pull back a little bit so we can see that process. So I've got a few sets now. I've got to be careful that the heat gun obviously doesn't preheat these and shrink them on. So the first ones I need to get on are these ones over here, because they're not going to slip right over the thicker insulation over there. Hopefully they go over the solder. Yes, they do. Let's get the helping hands out the way. Again, I must say I'm really chuffed. That fan, just at a low RPM, is pulling the kind of fumes away. So that works for me. Right, so next I have this heat tool, which as I explained is really handy. It's nice and small for doing heat shrink. It's got this plastic protective piece before you get to the metal, so there's far less risk of immediately burning yourself. This will get warm, but it's not going to have the immediate high temperature of that metal. And it's got this little handy stand, so if you wanted to do it that way, you could, or at least when you put it down, it's like that. So there we go, just a heads up, I did note when I was putting this down where it was pointing to, because obviously you could be pointing at something that's very heat sensitive or could burn or what have you. If you were pointing this at a very expensive instrument, that could be a problem. So just be aware of that. Right, so just to note, there we go, I've got those first two bits of heat shrink on there, and that's nicely insulated that soldering joint. So now we'll slip over the bigger piece, which hopefully is going to cover everything up and make it look neat. There we go. So I'm going to try and center it. So I just cover up that there. Now I must just check. Okay, so the insulation and the solder is about there. So that's fine. That'll keep things roughly covered up. There we go, and check, yep, you know, it's warm, but I certainly won't burn myself. As I say, they do recommend you don't, but at least you've got that level of protection on that little device. I must say, very handy, works very well. To date, it's the best thing I've had for kind of doing heat shrink, and Although you can clearly see the wires under here, it's all covered up and fairly safe for use. So next we go back to the other bench and start to power things up. Right, so at the point now where what I want to do is for one measure the input voltage, the mains voltage coming in and what I'm getting out on the actual DC plug itself. Just for fun, I've pulled out the U33A Agilent and the Bigger Brother 1272A to do that job. I've got some quite handy, I've been investing in some test leads, which hopefully will be, I don't have to sit there holding probes, hopefully I'll be able to pull out a pair which actually fit in nicely. What I want to see was whether I designed this so that I could pull everything out and I could work on it. There we go. So that should make life a little bit easier. I'm going to bring you in a little bit closer. I'm just going to go fish about and see if I can find those leads so I can take the measurement safely. Right, so the dilemma when you have so many new test leads. I've gone and bought some cheap test leads off Amazon. And then I've also gone and purchased, and if you ever go and search for Fluke test leads, this is the pack you get. They're rolled up in this pack. Obviously nice silicone leads. We'll be, as I said, we'll be doing a comparison in, with, let's say, Frankie and some I get from Barry to see which are work out to be the best and the best value. So I'll pick out from these which ones actually grip the inputs, the mains inputs, and then the ones that I can use to actually take a measurement from the tip itself. Right, and I was being a little bit hasty thinking I could measure the input because I've only got the live exposed where it goes through the fuse. The neutral, the other side, is obviously insulated. Now, let me just check the one thing else that's interesting. Then, so what I have done, I've got these two, I've used the Fluke clips. The one is on the board to pick up the negative, and I've got the kind of positive exposed through the fuse. So that's what I'm picking up there. That's going to be measured over here, and just for fun I'll measure what's coming out the tip just in case there is a difference. So I'm just about to plug in the mains. I've got it plugged into the strip at the moment but with the switch switched off. Okay, so nothing's live, and obviously remember we're working with a live now 110 120 volt circuit over here. So I'm going to go ahead and switch on. Hopefully it doesn't, nothing goes awry. No, and there we go. Okay, so 7 volts out, and that's kind of what we were expecting at the reduced voltage. Perhaps slightly higher than I was expecting. Let's just check what we are getting at the tip. I'll do the measurement. Sorry for leaning over things. Okay, so there we go. We're the same. So that was just a double check that there was nothing wrong in the cable. So now what I need to do is, as I said, is on these taps on the board, I've got it set up so that I'm just going between the two taps. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to measure the voltage across, right across, to see what the first across the kind of black, the kind of ground or zero wire, and the white, the 12 volt, or what was the 12 volts running at 220 volt, and then across the two white ones to see the potential difference between the two. Okay, so I've got everything switched off at the moment. I'm obviously handling the kind of low voltage end of it now anyway, but that doesn't matter. Things can go awry if you have things switched on and you suddenly don't realize what you're touching. So things are switched off at the moment. As you will recall from this exercise, what I did, I still soldered all three wires, all three taps from the transformer in here so that one wouldn't be floating free. One is in essence on here on a track that isn't being used. So now I'm going to the black one or zero or ground is sitting over here. I'm going to measure between the two that I'm using and then across to see what the voltage is there. Right, we're ready to go. Just switched on the power. Let's just make sure I get my bearings. So that should be the ground and that is the, of course, I'm sitting here measuring on DC and this is an AC signal coming in, silly boy. Okay, so 6.7, but that's an RMS 8, that's an AC value. So 6.7, And if I now go between the two, we're getting 13. So it's definitely double across. And remember, I was only looking for about 12 coming in. So now if I go between the two, use the potential difference or the voltage between the two outer taps, I should be okay on what I'm getting right through the circuit. And if you want to understand all the figures, facts and figures, go back and look at the previous video on this, because that'll explain the voltages right through the signal and obviously how it's working. Right, so all I need to do now is go back to the solder station and basically switch these two. So these two are currently providing the AC input into the bridge, and this one is not in use. So if I switch this one out for this one, bring this one across, then I've got that potential, that great potential difference across the center tap, and then that should do us fine. So let's go over to solder station and let's do that. Right, so I don't have my nice small little Panavice here yet, because that's coming in the container, but I do have this larger one that I purchased. So anyway, we'll make do. It clamps in there quite nicely, and I've just got this resting on the side, which will allow me to desolder and switch those wires across. Right, so it's basically these two solder joints over here that I need to undo, because it's the wires under there which I need to switch around. So I've got a solder sucker. I've not used it before. It's one that I bought off Amazon. So let's see how we go. And of course, I'm thinking I'm going to have to suck the solder out, but I don't. It's nice and straightforward. I can just take them out the hole silly boy. Well, I say that, and I can't necessarily see the hole that clearly. So let's see how it works. I've got it. Oh, there we go. May as well see how it works now that I've got it out. Ah, very clean. Must say again, this is one that I read reviews on, and people were saying it worked well and it had metal threads. So that cleared off the solder quite nicely over there. So let me do the switch. So I need the white wire now as part of the circuit. There we go, right one at last. What I'm going to do is just nip that over so it doesn't fall out. There we go, and unfortunately at this level I don't have my lovely little vent to take the fumes away, but I say once I'm working lower down, then that won't be an issue. Right, let's do the next one. Okay, and that last one obviously is just merely to keep it from dangling around. It's not playing a part in the circuit. So let's have a look. They would seem to be all right. Don't really need clipping. There's enough space in the box. Right, so let's put it back in the box and go and see if we've got enough power and put it on a load and see if it works. Right, so the proof of the pudding is obviously going to be now to put it back together and then take a measurement on the tip to see what we're getting out there. The ultimate test is going to be for me to put a load on this just to see how it is performing under load. Before we do the load test, what we'll do, I'll go to the kind of theory circuit diagram of the full wave center tapped AC to DC converter, and we'll have a look at that. But anyway, let me get this back together as best I can. And I suppose before I close it right up, I should just power it on and check what voltage we are getting. My goodness, yeah, it's the new one, and if you remember from the review, that irritating melody it plays. Okay, I've switched the power off, I'm plugging it in, now switching it on. Okay, the LED has come on, so that's a good sign. Now then, is there something I should have been aware of? The one thing I needed to be aware of is that the capacitor that I've got in here is a 25 volt capacitor, but that should be fine because obviously voltages have halved, even though I've gone and now doubled up with the taking the voltage across the two outer taps. So let's just have a look. 12, 0.06. Now then, okay, so I've got my, I was just double checking, I've got my probes the wrong way around, that's why it's negative. I just think, oops, have I done something wrong, which shouldn't have gone wrong, but that's fine, it's negative because I got the probes the wrong way around. So I can tell that under load, this is gonna probably drop to around 11 and a half again, which is fine for my application, but somewhere I've got a loss in there, which wasn't the case when I had it on the breadboard. Okay, so before we go to actually put it under load, let's just have a look at the circuit design. Right, so as I said, what I want to just quickly show you is where the advantages of having a sense-tap transformer. So this is obviously the circuit diagram of a transformer which has just got two tappings that come off it, and then obviously you need a full four diodes to do your rectification if you want full wave rectification. So obviously when you've got this side being positive, the current flows down this way through that diode, comes through your load, back up, round, and back out. And likewise, when it flows the other way, it comes up this way, through your load, back up, out, and round, and obviously maintains the polarity here. So with a center tap, and I said, I didn't realize this until I did some investigation before the other tutorial. So this would be a center tap. So on the secondary side, you've got that center tap, which you obviously see that black wire. The two outer ones here would represent the white wires on my transformer. And I was initially only using the center and the 12 volt, but now I'm using both across. Obviously now in the States, with because I've got the reduced mains voltage coming in this side, I've got a reduced voltage over here. So that's why I'm now going across the two. But I'm still using it going through a full wave bridge rectifier. But you can, you see, do have just two diodes when you've got a center tap. And obviously how that works is when you've got the current, the AC cycle, the wave coming through, so you've got current flow through this way, it flows through your load down here and then back through your center tap over here. So you've got your direction of the flow, your single polarity DC voltage going through that way, and when it switches and it goes through this way, it merely goes up this way, up here, and again through the same way, and then out through the center tap. So I must say, quite a neat solution. There are also ways with a center tap you can set up capacitors and like boost the voltage and then have a switch to actually switch between different AC inputs. But that I'll save for another day, for another exercise. But there you go, that's what a center tap full wave rectifier looks like. Right, so here we go. I've got obviously got the power supply all screwed up and ready to be tested. I've got some wires or a probe and wire clip, crocodile clip set up to read the actual tip. And they are going into my electronic DC load, which is ultimately what this is being built to power. But at the moment, I've got another wall wart powering it. So as you can see, we've got it showing that 12 point what have you volts. And I'm going to now dial up the load, a constant current load. And as I said, so the goal ultimately, it needs to be able to supply about 4650 milliamp, because this is what this uses. And I want to see what's going to happen at 100. So let's go up, and as we can see, things are starting to fall off as I dial it up. Let's go to 50. So there we go. We're only just below 12 volts at 50 milliamp. Let's go up to the 100, which was my, and there we go. So now we drop below, let's take it to 100, see where it is going to go to. And it drops around right down to 10.3. So fortunately, I say, it'll work for my application, but at some point in time, I probably want to open that up again, have a look inside and see if we can troubleshoot where that loss is, because it worked on the breadboard, but it's certainly having a greater loss here. So, but for my application, it'll power this. In fact, what I'll do right now is switch the power supply just to see that it does power it up. There we go, 1, 2, 3, bingo, okay. And it was always gonna work because this only works off about 6 volts, but this itself has a voltage regulator inside it. But I say, I wanted to build a 12 volts AC to DC converter. So done and dusted. So at least now we can get down to testing. I can show you the configuration of this with my Metrics multimeter to test energy storage devices, whether they be batteries, supercapacitors, lithium iron phosphate, or what have you.
Right, so I hope you enjoyed or gained some value out of that little exercise. As I said, I could have done it all off camera. It was just a case of kind of coming along for the ride. Now, if you find that kind of thing of some value and there's some pearls of wisdom to be gained in that kind of video, then certainly do let me know. I'm certainly not going to do all the bits and pieces that I might be fiddling around with in the background on camera, because it would be too time consuming and I'm sure boring for a lot of people. But there might be little bits and pieces like that that might be interesting. Now, as I said, what this is going to lead to is to me putting these devices like these lithium batteries and these kind of supercapacitors onto either that electronic DC load or onto my main Nuo load to test them. Now, some of these are quite interesting. I looked at, this happens to be a boost cap by the company Maxwell, and the specs for this are quite scary. You can charge this, if I recall, this is a 350 farad capacitor. You can charge this at 30 amps. And you can discharge this, if you're not careful, can discharge over 800 amps. So this is potentially quite a dangerous little device, and that's why one needs to be careful when testing these, because that could certainly gotcha. But anyway, that's certainly going to be coming up also. Although I know some people, when I mentioned I was kind of getting some more Manuo kit, this electronic power supply and DC source was one of them. So this is the M8813. But they are busy working on an M66 series, if I've got the name correct. And that is a device which acts as a power supply or a charger, programmable charger, and a load. So you can program it to cycle batteries, cell phone batteries, all these devices. So as opposed to me having to manually charge something and discharge it and measure it, that device, by all accounts, does all of that. And as soon as that comes onto the market, I'm going to snap one up, because that'll be a great little device for testing these devices. Anyway, thanks very much. If you do enjoy the video, please do remember to give it a thumbs up, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.
Tester.co.uk